Let's take a look at the idea here of experimental design and data collection. This is a data analysis class, so obviously we have to be able to collect data so that we can actually analyze it to begin with. So let's briefly go over the learning objectives. These are some of the points, the key points that we want to be able to make sure we get out of these next several videos. First of all, we want to understand the different sources of error. Sources of error are very important. We want to identify the different sources of error that occur when measurements are being made. There's always going to be error. That's always going to happen. So if we can understand what the sources are, where they come from, we can help control it and work with it and still have meaningful results. We want to be able to recognize the different types of experiments that can be conducted. So again, we're going to introduce some new terminology. We want to understand the importance of randomization in data collection. Randomization is an extremely important concept. We need to talk about that. And we want to utilize different sampling techniques. We need to talk about the different sampling techniques in the data collection process. Okay, let's take a look here and at the idea of good research. What exactly is good research? Well, good research generates dependable data. Dependable data is reliable. In other words, it's representative of the population. It hasn't been messed with, manipulated to get a specific result. Data is data. It is what it is. We want it to be very reliable. We want it to look like the population that we're interested in and then use it to bring us to whatever conclusions it's going to bring us to. Now, the data will be obtained via methods that are mathematically and scientifically sound. In other words, for this class, we're going to talk about three different sampling techniques. And you should stick to those sampling techniques. You shouldn't be going out making up your own sampling technique. Now, if you get an advanced degree in statistics, you understand the process of sampling, and you need to come up with a sampling technique, and you understand how to reduce error in the sampling technique, that's another story. But for now, we want to stay with established methods. Either way, if you do create your own mathematically or your own sampling technique later on in life, it needs to be mathematically and scientifically sound. It needs to be solid. Now, appropriate research ethics is absolutely paramount. It's extremely important. The goal of any and actually all legitimate, the key word here is legitimate research, should be that of determining to the best of your ability the true status of a particular topic. What's really going on right now with this particular topic that we're interested in? What's really going on in politics right now? Not what we can make it look like, but what is really going on? What's really going on with this new drug that's being tested? Not what do we stand to gain monetarily if we can show that this drug works, but what's really happening with this drug. I'm sure that you've heard someone say before that, you know, something to the effect of, what good are statistics? You make them say anything you want. Well, that's true. That's absolutely true, but it's only true of the unethical. Because you can collect data, analyze it, and say, oh, that's not the result I wanted, so I'm going to change some numbers here. Or I'm going to use a different technique that I think will give me the result that I want. That is incredibly unethical. There's a famous quote, there's lies, damn lies, and then statistics. You know, that falls under this idea that unethical people can take data, twist it, and get any result that they want. Something that we want to do whenever we're doing any type of data analysis, we want to try to employ the scientific method as much as possible. And we can help reduce the probability of faulty research by maintaining these standards. First of all, clearly define your purpose. If you don't know why you're collecting data, then why are you collecting data? You shouldn't be doing it. If you don't know what you're trying to establish, then why are you going out to get data? I want to produce a detailed explanation of the research process. Don't try to hide something. State very clearly what you did, how you did it, and why you did it. It may be very legitimate, but perhaps I'm reading an article that you wrote, and I'm thinking, nah, I don't agree with that, so I'm not going to use your results. That doesn't mean you're wrong. It means that you gave me the ability to make my own decision. Be very, very detailed. Be very upfront with what you did. If you know there's limitations to your research, state what the limitations are. Again, don't try to hide something. If you know, hey, the sample may not have been the greatest because yada, 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 then say it. It doesn't totally invalidate your research, but just say what really happened. Justify your conclusions. We don't say it is because it is. Justify it. What about the data actually led you to believe that particular conclusion? And you want to provide the raw data in an appendix, if at all possible, or if at all reasonable. Now, if you're working as a consultant, you may be working with proprietary data. So a hospital may not allow you, or a business may not allow you to publish the actual raw data, and that's fine. But most cases, it is very possible to actually provide the raw data. You may have to massage it like a little bit. Suppose, well, as an example, I've done some consulting with the hospitals, and they've always given me permission to use their data. However, I have to sanitize it. I have to make sure all patient numbers are taken out so nobody could ever say, this is patient number 275581. If there are names attached, all the names have to come out, any identifying information, anything that could possibly be used by anybody to take that piece of data and say it came from that person has to be removed. Once that's done, then I've always received permission to use any data that I've obtained as part of a consulting project. And removing that type of information does not invalidate the data in any way. Do you really need to know that that piece of data came from Mary down the street? No. Junk science is a very, very serious issue. The basic definition of junk science is it's the use of faulty scientific data, so the data is faulty, or faulty analysis of otherwise good data. So commonly, junk science is used intentionally by various components of the media to instill some type of shock factor for a story. Politicians tend to use it to prove their point. Although if you walk up to politicians and say, why'd you use that junk science? They probably have no clue what that term even means. Businesses sometimes will employ the concepts of junk science, sometimes knowingly and sometimes not, to bolster their product and or to attack a competitor's product. You know, something not quite so dramatic of any of these. I'm sure you heard that there are elements in chocolate that are good for you. There are certain components of chocolate that can help increase metabolic rates or help something. So the conclusion would be that we should all be eating 10 pounds of chocolate a day. See, that's junk science. It's taking good data and coming up with these faulty conclusions with it. That's ridiculous. Same thing can be said about wine. Quite often you hear that red wine is good for you. Well, there's a lot more to the story about red wine being good to you than or good for you than simply start drinking 3 or 4 bottles of red wine a day. That's not going to work. See, all of those would be, in one form or another, junk science. You should really just Google junk science. And I haven't checked lately, but there was a really nice website called junkscience.com. You may want to take a look and see if it's still there. All kinds of examples of junk science. You should familiarize yourself with these concepts because you could find yourself right in the middle of junk science without even realizing it. So the more you understand this concept, the better equipped you will be to avoid it yourself.